So, ladies and gentlemen, it is fitting that on this Father's Day occasion, I have the honor of introducing our speaker, the first man. Okay. So I'll just delay that introduction. By the way, so that you know, my wife tell me that if I come up here and buck shuffle, she just go and drive out. You know, total embarrassment. So, you know, if you see she driving out, you know what it is. First, we have some power talks that will be done. I want to invite, firstly, Clive Edwards to do a power talk. Clive? Please give him a round of applause as he's done.
Good morning. Reverend John had asked me to, on Father's Day, spend a few brief moments sharing with you the changes, the ideas, the pleasures that have come from my experience in grandfathering. It's not a power talk. It's just not. So I will certainly seek to share those ideas, but it's not a power talk. I just thought I'd make five brief points. The first point from the experience of grandfathering is the whole idea, when you reach the stage of life in calendar years, and you start describing things still as indescribable, it's unusual. I want a show of hands for all the grandfathers in here. Show of hands. I suspect that you will share with me the idea that it is in fact indescribable. You can't really speak fluently about the experience, but you know how it is when you experience it. So that's the indescribable aspect of it. And so I've also had the pleasure of experiencing that indescribable nature of grandfathering. Also, if you have been gone through the years and you have attained some level of maturity, you have pretty well established strategic thinking and strategic experiences. But I believe that when you become a grandfather, you really expand that strategic approach. And one of the important things about this strategy is that you can take them back home. Or if you're operating in their space, you can leave their space and go back to yours. Very important strategic expansion that I was not aware of until I became a grandfather. The third point is that you can elicit a source of amazement from your grandkids. I mean, my granddaughter, I always have issues with her and her use of the tablet and the DS and the handheld instruments. I believe kids must spend more time out there exploring and innovating. But then, you know, that's obviously generational. So we always have this little discussion. And she says, well, what did you do when you were a child? And I explained to her growing up in the country, we never had light, we never had TV, and I expressed with great delight the innovation that we created as we went out and got Seymour grass blooms to catch lizards or other such similar exercises. She looked at me with great amazement and says, oh, Pops, you must have had a very awful childhood. So you do can, at this stage of grandfathering, still elicit amazement from another generation. The fourth point is that it really teaches you to mind your own business. Because I grew up in a household, in a culture at the time when children should be seen and not heard. Now, my mother was a progressive. So my father would come into the house and see myself and my sister and my mother in the bed chatting, and he would look at her, not with pleasure, not with admiration, and he would just say, you don't know the child from the parent. And so I thought I would extend that type of collaboration and camaraderie to my generation, but not realizing consciously that generations move in their idea of progression. So what's progressive for me certainly wouldn't be progressive for my kids. And so in their parenting, I learned to mind my own business. I learned as much as I could not to parent, just to enjoy them and do my best not to patient. At times, I've had to use patience not to parent, but it's a very important learning. And the fifth point, and the last point I would share, is the idea of letting them fly. And I had that experience, personal experience, recently, or I'm having it, in that I've always encouraged my kids to live in other cultures, study elsewhere, experience the world, that you are part of this globe, and you should experience it as much as you can and would like to. I have, and I encourage them to do it. But when my son-in-law, 6 months ago, accepted a contract in Dubai, it meant for the first time in my own experience, physically, I would be in a country without any one of my kids. In the States, I'm with a child, but in Jamaica, I will not be after Thursday with a child physically. And I had to do, surprisingly, a lot of self-talk. I had to wade through the emotions around that. And you know, spirit can't be tired. Spirit can't be impatient. But spirit said to me one day, enough of this. You've processed it enough. Keep out your mouth and mind your own business. Get out of the people them business. It's their business, it's not yours. Your business is about the father's business. Preparing your children and their children to soar and to fly and strengthen those wings in whatever way you can. And you have done that work. It's now their business to soar and fly and experience the life as they choose. And you know, spirit has a sense of humor. Spirit couldn't finish without a sense of humor, saying, and by the way, who do you know can go to Bali or Dubai and not pay hotel fees? So keep your mouth and relax. So in summary, grandfathering is about expressing the father's business. And I've had such great pleasure in expressing the father's business, and in so doing, learning more about what expressing the father's business is. It's been a wonderful work in progress. I love it, and I will continue to enjoy it. Thank you all.
Listen, before I invite the other person to join the podium, I just want us to recognize that the Templars share with us a wonderful gift as fathers. For those of you who are not aware, we have gotten microwavable popcorns. On it read, there's a label on it that reads, for hot pops. So let's give the Templar a round of applause for those ideas. Just want to, at this time, invite Mr. George Young to come and share an experience about fatherhood.
Good morning, Templar family.
Good morning.
Science of mind teaching, you need to be centered. Good morning again, Temple family. This week I was at a Ministry of Justice training, and one of the rules, you are not to use your cell phone in the training. So I put my cell phone on silence. I saw it wrong. Reverend John. Now, when Reverend John calls, you know you break other rules to facilitate him. And I answered. And he said, Junior, this Sunday is Father's Day, and I'm asking if you could come and share how the science of mind teaching has helped you to be a father figure / mentor. And I said, sure. So I took up the challenge, and here I am. I want to thank the temple for this opportunity. Through modalities such as poetry, meditation, daily affirmations, and Thursday classes facilitated by Reverend John, I have been able to be in tune with my God self. With sense of mind teachings, I no longer see with my eyes, but with my soul. Therefore, I'm always aware of the Christ within everyone. And this, for me, helps working with young people, especially unattached youth. You know, the self-fulfilling prophecy. And therefore, you know, I no longer see illusions such as you are lazy, you are bad, or you are a liar. As a result, I'm now pouring fuel on the Christ-conscious spark within others. This is realized by reminding them of who they are. You are shaped in the image and likeness of God. God's mind is your mind. You are one with God. Can you turn to your neighbors and say that for me, please? Thank you. Hence, being a mentor / father figure is natural, as my daily disposition of perennial happiness, ever-growing faith, and unconditional love, a foundation built by the teachings of science of mind, has established a module which demonstrates live as though I am living. Since one's actions are much more compelling than their words. Years ago, when I met Reverend John, he used to came to my home, and we'll have some sessions. I'm going to say, express yourself, put them on paper, put them on writing. You know, I took his advice, and I put something on writing that I call firelight. And I just want to share it with you. Firelight, firelight, oh so bright and right, my spiritual blindness you turn into sight. So I look with my eyes and see with my spiritual sight. I now see the colorful wind, my guardian angel Edison, and the gracious seraphim. The once mystical mountains I now comprehend. Look! Firelight, firelight, now I'm traveling the universe. Oh, what bright lights. My firelight delivers and shares because it cares. You know what? My firelight, firelight will only get bright. Heart of love.
Right. Thank you, George. I just want to say thanks again to both grandfather and father who has come up to share with us. Give them another round of applause. And now I get the opportunity to introduce our speaker. So when Reverend John called me and asked me, I saw the missed call like George did from Reverend John. I said, oh, Reverend is asking me to speak and I'm getting ready and you know, full of myself and everything, and even start preparing before I return the call. Reverend John said, I have a big favor I'm asking you. So what is that? You know, just ready to say yes. So I'm going to ask you to be platform assistant. So, you know, with that I say, okay. But little did he know the pleasure that he was giving me to introduce our speaker this morning. And as I indicated before, it's very fitting that I'm doing this introduction. I have the honor, as I say, to introduce the first man to not only tell me, that I am a father, but to provide proof by showing me my son some 17 years ago. I guess it's one of the joys of being a radiologist. So, with an ever cool and calm demeanor, Freddie, as he's affectionately called, is a longtime favorite of so many of our temple members, including our founder, Dr. Reverend Elman Lumsden. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands and join me in welcoming to the podium the cool, calm, and collected Mr. Winston Freddie Clarke.
Never heard so many lies in life.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And let me stay in touch with precedence and protocol to say, let me add my words of welcome to those of my assistant, to all those within earshot, and also in cyberspace. Complete, sir? Yesterday, we reflect on our fathers. Yesterday, we reflect on our fathers, whether living or dead, absent or present, sperm donors or not. And I recently saw a study coming out of the United States which indicated that around 65% of inmates in penal institutions came from single family homes, and where that provider in that home would be either a mother or a grandmother. And I'd like to ask you to just walk away with that thought today, one of the many which I'm sure you'll walk away with, and ask the question why. Nonetheless, we will say Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day not just to the fathers present, but also the throng of ladies which have been fathers to their children. I think we'll all agree that our father's role in our lives first was that of a provider. Then our father's enforced discipline, coupled with firm guidance and moral mentoring. These were qualities which our fathers brought to the table. My father always talked about principle, which I now know is that which comes as an a priori to law, that which is. Is yesterday, is today, is tomorrow, and is forevermore. That which cannot be changed, that which is God. That within which there is no change, but in which we are privileged to change. Several years ago, one of my close female colleagues accosted me, and she said words like this, Freddie, don't you think you have made enough money by this? Freddie, don't you think you should now give your life to the Lord and serve the church? Well, I don't know how you would have responded to that. Because when we were young, we felt that we were clever, and I'll be quoting a lot of people here now. Nothing is coming from me, others. And so we thought we were clever. We had hubris. And we would want to change everybody and change everything. But now that I am viewing within range that 70th decade, I know instead we must change ourselves. We must be the change within the changeless. One of the results of that experience was that I determined to keep a book in which I would write quotations from my daily readings, quotations which inspired me. And I call that my spiritual toolbox. And it is the contents of this spiritual toolbox which I plan to leave with you today, and which I would like to see us add to the tools available to us as we tread this path called evolution, evolving through the teachings of the science of mind. The Temple of Light exists so that we can be provided with the tools of spiritual mind healing treatment, which is scientific prayer, not supplication, but recognition and acknowledgement. It provides us with the skill of meditation, visioning, spiritual counseling. It also provides with inspirational books and valuable classes. And I would like to ask you now to add to that my spiritual toolbox. Because if we succeed and acquire a vision of nirvana, which is heaven consciousness, that requires, according to Joseph Campbell, who was one of Reverend Elmer's favorites, the extinguishing, and listen to this, of the threefold fire of desire, hostility, and delusion. The extinguishing of the ego, I would simply say. Here the physical man yields not to his own wishes, but looks unto his God self. And as Ernest Holmes says, spirituality is not a thing. It is the atmosphere of God's presence, goodness, truth, and beauty. And in the spiritual world in which we live and move and have our beings, there is enough for all. Reverend Elmer, and I think the word here is diligence, left that word with us. And humbly, I would like to add discipline. So here are the scriptures. Discipline, to be sure, is never pleasant at times. It becomes painful. But afterwards, those who have been trained by it reap the harvest of peaceful and upright life. And that comes from Hebrews. And an important point, and this is from the Talmud. Man makes a harness for his beast. All the more should he make one for the beast within himself, his evil desires. It is true, the discipline of a definite spiritual practice, that we ascend the mountain of spiritual unfoldment. and to know that our bodies are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in us. This is probably the final step as we move to nirvana, God consciousness. To attain this requires discipline. So here, Ernest Holmes, our founder, as we have now encouraged to let go of the dross, let go of the petty, let go of the doubt, the guilt, and the fear. And here he says, there is no sin but ignorance of the truth. And there is no punishment but the consequence of mistake. In our actions, their own punishment comes, so there is no God to condemn. There is no God to judge. This is encouragement. And from Timothy again we hear, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. This takes us to hope and confidence. And again, from the toolbox comes this quote, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Doesn't all this take away tons of burden from our shoulders? It has done that for me. And what is the reward? As we abandon guilt, fear, resentment, hate, so shall thy presses burst with new wine. And that's from Proverbs. Friends, we are called away to flush away all that is negative and embrace the positive. One big challenge we all face is being judgmental. But let us then hear these words. God does not see those in prisons as bad, those walking the street as immoral, those at war as evil, or those abusing as insane. No one in the world is outside the circle of God's love. Experiences which others have and which we ourselves have must never be regarded as gravestones, because in the light of spirituality, they are awesome stepping stones. For there is nothing that love cannot face. There is no limit to its faith, its hope, its endurance, from the Corinthians. This is the love of God. This is the love which I call hard food. The hard food which we are obliged to take in this place, working on ourselves. And as Reverend Elmer would say, it's me, it's me. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. And how glorious it is to know ye are God's and all of you are sons of the Most High, from the Psalms. And then these words come from the toolpan. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven
give good things to those that ask of him. So thy son shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon withdraw itself, for the Lord shall be thine everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended. Only diligent practice and discipline will allow fruiting of the Spirit in us. We can now talk the language then of love, hope, forgiveness, and truly attain God consciousness. And somehow at this time, we must remember that answer from Peter when asked by the Christ, whom do men say that I am? And this was the Christ's answer: thou art the Christ. No, Peter's answer: thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Many of us forget that that was not the end of that quotation, because afterwards, three very important words were uttered by the Christ: that thou art. You are the Christ. I am the Christ, the Son of the living God. Through these quotations, my friends, I have taken you to the numinosa, to become individualized expressions of God, and as individuals who have no peer, who have no likeness to anyone else, perfect, whole and complete, doers of the word, and not only hearers, deceiving our own selves. God's channels, its minds, its hands, its feet, its heart, its very existence. So let us go back and hear a few words. And this is that great assurance: I am the Lord thy God, I change not, from Malachi. There is nothing to fear but fear itself. And as Ernest Holmes said, what is God but the intelligent life principle running through everything, sustaining and animating everything? So now we are free to ask, because it shall be given unto us. We are free to seek, because we shall find that pearl of great price. And we are free to knock, because unto us that door will always be open. I remember one of our late church members, her name was Dolly Dujon, and she would say, armed with the gifts and the tools of the Spirit, Freddie, you don't know how many walls I've walked through. I say that today. In the last 5 years, I have been having an experience which is beyond all other. Daily, the manna flows, and I have come to realize that when God calls you to his service, he pays all the bills. Namaste.